All of Microsoft's actions have been completely legal and good for consumers.
Paranoia strikes deep into your life, it will creep.
So this video is going to be a 2-in-1. I will be going over the computer itself and how it's set up so far, but the main thing I wanted to talk about is Microsoft. That 2030 vision video they released, they were dead serious. That's what they want to do, and that's what they're going to do. They even have a new word for it now, an agentic OS. I briefly mentioned why having AI integrated into the operating system is a bad idea in my 2030 vision video, but I didn't really go into too much detail because to me at the time it wasn't going to be immediate. This was their plan to move forward into 2030, so I figured we would have some more time before they started throwing this in our faces and forcing us to use it. Or at least trying to. I'll get to that later. But they're doing it now. It's right now. They're doing it with Windows 11. Instantly. As fast as they could start executing that 2030 plan, they're doing it. At this point, computers sold with Windows 11 pre-installed are the same thing as that big carved wooden presidential seal that the Soviet Union gave to the United States. They're completely bugged. Microsoft, and by extension, their Copilot AI, which is their number one tool for this, by the way, has full access to your computer, has full access to the files on your system. They can even lock you out of your system if they ever desired to do so. I should not be forced to give out my personal data and personally identifiable information to companies and advertisers just to use a computer. And that's the goal here, is eventually to make it to where just to use a computer, you have to agree to all of that. Because Microsoft has such a large stranglehold on the market, both desktops and laptops, chances are you're going to end up with a Windows 11 computer. And if you don't install a different operating system on it, you have to agree to all that Windows 11 does just to use it. And that's insane. That's crazy. You've already paid for the computer. You've already paid for Windows. Why do they need that data to make even more money? It's insane. A few years ago, the general consensus was that if something was free, you were the product. And that's how it was. That's, you know, when people were talking about Google services and Gmail and things like that. If it was free, you were the product. Nowadays, that's not the case anymore. You're always the product. Whether you've spent money on the computer or the operating system or not, you are still the product. So if you're using any software from any major tech company, whether it's paid software or not, your data is being sold, and you are being tracked to make sure that the ads that get served to you are the most likely to be clicked on and responded to. Of course, there are varying levels to this behavior on a company-to-company basis, but the big ones to really watch out for are going to be Microsoft, Google, Amazon, and Meta. That's the four worst for doing this kind of stuff. And the thing is, with a lot of these companies, you generally have options to avoid all this garbage, just don't use certain online services. The problem comes when Microsoft is introduced. Where Microsoft has that dominating operating system market share, they have a lot more power and control to get data from PC users than these other companies do. I feel I should mention that Google does have this same level of control over Android smartphones, but strictly speaking and talking about PCs and laptops and desktops, Microsoft has the edge there. Now, if you're still on Windows 10 and looking for a way to avoid Windows 11, do not get a new Chromebook, because Google is developing a new Chrome OS version called Aluminium, which is just as bad as Windows 11, if not worse. It also has AI built into the operating system. It has the same, if not worse, level of surveillance for advertising. It's you're basically just jumping out of the frying pan and into the fire if you get a Chromebook. If you have an older Chromebook, I would keep an eye out for that in case they try to force upgrade old Chrome OS versions to this new worthless garbage. Now, you may have noticed that I haven't mentioned Apple yet, and that's because I'm pretty sure they have the same goals in mind as Microsoft and these other companies, but their AI system is just behind the other companies. I think the moment that Apple Intelligence catches up to Copilot and Gemini and ChatGPT, it's going to be the same deal. I think it'll be rolled into the operating system. It'll provide features like remembering everything you do on the computer and doing things for you on the computer, which in turn just gives Apple the ability to see everything on your computer and everything you're doing on the computer. I highly doubt that they're not going to take this route because it's the most monetarily sound route for these companies to take right now. With all that being said, I find it really sad that it's this shockingly difficult for somebody looking to just buy and use a normal computer. We should be advancing. It should be getting better, not worse. Computers should be getting faster, not slower. And because of all this AI software and all this surveillance garbage, they're getting slower. These companies are using resources on your hardware to benefit themselves. Of the very few options remaining for somebody who just wants a normal computer, the one I've chosen is Linux. Now, I'm not gonna claim everything just worked instantly out of the box. There were some settings I had to change, there were some configuration changes I had to make, but I thought it was going to be a lot worse than it was. For any old school or experienced computer user that started out with MS-DOS and Windows 3.1 or before, or Windows 95 or 98, I would say this is more than a valid option because it's about the same level of difficulty. It's really not that bad. And once you get it working, it just works. You don't have to worry about it anymore. So for that little amount of time I spent getting things working, now I no longer have to worry about Microsoft looking over my shoulder at everything I do and selling that data to advertisers. I no longer have to worry about AI being forced into my operating system when I don't want it or need it. I don't have to worry about code in my operating system being written by AI. And yes, about 30% of Microsoft's code is written by AI. They admitted that themselves. And it just works. I can just turn on my computer and do what I need to do with it. And that's it. And for the average user that's just using their computer to browse the web and do basic tasks, Linux is even easier to set up. The only reason I had any issue is because I have a very new graphics card, and Linux can sometimes take some time to catch up and get the right drivers and things set up. But my version of Linux fully supports my video card. I just had to get Steam working properly because the default version of Steam in the App Store uses a different version of a 3D accelerator driver than the system uses. So once I downloaded a different version of Steam, it works just fine, and everything works pretty much out of the box if you're not gaming and if you don't have incredibly new graphics hardware. One of the best parts about Linux is that, excepting some specific cases like Zorin OS, Linux is free. And it's not free in the same way that Google services are free or Microsoft's Windows 11 upgrade is free, where they just steal your data to offset the cost. It's free and open source. So instead of it being led by one big company that's just using it as a platform to suck all the data they can from you, it's a community-driven thing, so people come together to make it and make it better, and you don't have companies spying on everything you do and then selling it all to advertisers and getting rich while you get nothing out of it. If you're interested in making the jump to Linux, I've linked some videos in the description below that helped me get started. It was really nice to see that the people that know a lot more about Linux than I do are freely sharing their knowledge online so that everybody has the best chance of getting away from all of this worthless garbage that they can get. With all of that out of the way, now it's time for the hardware part of the video and kind of what I've got set up so far. I say so far because I'm not entirely done. There's still a couple things I need to look into buying or setting up to get it completely finished, but for the most part, it's pretty much done. To start, I'll show you it booting up and then show you NeoFetch, which is one of many ways to get a list of your hardware specs in Linux. And then I'll explain why I made some of the decisions I made with what hardware I bought. As usual, it's a very old computer case, except this time it just happens to be an old server case. When I got it, there was a Duron 800 security camera server built into it. It had 400 gigabytes of storage across two 200 gigabyte IDE disks. The way I found out it was a security camera server is because there was this really weird looking card in there that had what appeared to be two VGA ports on it. And as I started Googling the chips and everything in it, I realized that it was a security camera input card thing, which can handle the input from a bunch of cameras at once. I don't know, it was just really strange. I decided to go with a Ryzen 9 9900X. I could have went with a 9950X3D or something similar, but the problem with those CPUs is that the TDP is way too high. We're talking like 170 watts. And I'd rather not have a CPU that heats to the temperature of the surface of the sun while trying to do something. It's just way too much power draw. The 9900X does a bit better with a TDP of 120 watts, so I figured that was a decent enough compromise between performance and how much power the CPU was drawing. This system is completely air-cooled. There's nobody on this planet that's going to be able to convince me that liquid cooling is a good idea. If you use a liquid cooler, more power to you. I just don't trust the things. I've had one fail on me before, and it killed a $2,400 computer, so I will not touch those with a 10-foot pole. For the video card, I decided to go with a Radeon 9070 XT. I really did not want an NVIDIA card because of all of their AI garbage. Not that AMD is really any better, but NVIDIA just takes it to a special level.
If this doesn't work out, if all of you object, well, just get used to it. I really think you have to let this sink in. In another hour or so, you're going to feel good about it.
I hope as good as warrior.
Aside from that, it has 64 gigabytes of DDR5 6000 CL30 and a Western Digital 2TB NVMe drive. I did buy four 2TB hard disks. I was going to do RAID 10 with the motherboard's integrated SATA controller, but unfortunately the graphics card is so long, I couldn't put the HDD drive cage back into the case and have it all fit. So I'm either going to have to buy a DAS, like a USB direct attached storage, or build a NAS. And I do have an i7-2600S laying around that I could turn into a NAS. I just don't know if I want to mess with all the network configuration, because I've never done that before. And if I can just get them all in RAID 10 and plug it into a USB into my main computer and stop with that, then I don't see why I shouldn't do that. that about wraps it up for this video. I really appreciate you guys watching. I just wanted to throw it out there that I had switched to Linux in the hopes that maybe it would help some people who have only ever really used Windows also switch over. I used Windows for years. I've used Windows for most of my life, but I just can't deal with this anymore. I also wanted to show that Linux isn't just for your old Windows 10 computer that can't run Windows 11. Linux can be for a brand new computer. This computer has never run Windows, nor will it ever. As soon as I got it built, I installed Ubuntu on it, and that's what it's been running since. So, either way, whether you've got an old Windows 10 computer and you can't go to Windows 11, which is really more of a blessing than a curse, or you're building a new computer, or you've bought a new computer even, you do not have to use Windows 11. You can get rid of that, and you can get away from it, and make your computer your computer.
I would have waited an eternity for this. It's over, Prime.